Hi, my name is Ambrose, and welcome to a new episode of my series entitled How to Score Study. In today's lesson, we are going to be taking a look at Maurice Ravel's three poems by Mallarme. This lesson will be in two parts. One, we are going to go over an introduction, score prep, and study techniques. In part two, we will do an overview and analysis of the first movement of Ravel's three poems of Mallarme, entitled Soupir, utilizing the aforementioned techniques and methods. Intro and part one. This lesson is called How to Score Study because score studying is its own discipline, and like any other discipline, it requires practice, time, and edification. My goal here is not to show you the end result, how or why a composition works musically. It's to show you the linear process of breaking down a score. This will help you decode everything from harmonic analysis to orchestration techniques. I will show you my score as we go, and you will see how marked up they are and what kind of notes I make as I read through a given score. Additionally, this series is meant to bring light to some rare gems, some overlooked or underrepresented works of the classical repertoire. Part 1b, How I Score Study. 1. Collect the materials, including score, text, and translations. I prefer to purchase scores if I am able to. If not, I often use IMSLP, a website which provides many PDF and MIDI files of scores in the public domain. I will provide a link in the description box. 2. Gather pencils and colored pencils. 3. Write in the translation of the text, if applicable. 4. Write in timestamps every few pages or at pivotal moments. This is to help you avoid wasting time if you get lost while sight reading the score, particularly in longer movements. 5. Do a harmonic analysis of the entire piece. Try not to get bogged down with details, as answers may present themselves over time as you further analyze the piece. Number 6. Write in the general harmonic language to help you decode. Is this a straightforward piece that I can analyze, something by Mozart, for example? Or do I need to be focused on something like the general mode or synthetic scale being employed, rather than a standard vertical analysis? The latter is how we will approach Ravel's poems by Mallarme. 7. Write in question marks for any questions you may have. Is this the 5 of 6, or have we modulated, for example? Number 8. Color code key staves to help guide the eye to necessary spots, particularly after page turns and system breaks. As you can see, I have marked the chant or voice stave in blue. 9. Underline interesting moments, orchestration techniques, instances of word painting, or anything else that catches your attention. If you can't tell the thesis of this video so far, it is essentially, do not be afraid to mark up your scores. A little historical background to set the scene. Ravel's Mallarme poems is a chamber work in three movements scored for soprano, two flutes, two clarinets, piano, and string quartet, based on poems by Stephen Mallarme, the most cherished of all French poets. The work was published in 1913. The work came about as other composers were experimenting with somewhat unorthodox chamber ensembles. Ravel was directly influenced by Stravinsky's Three Japanese Lyrics, who in turn was inspired by Schoenberg's song cycle, Pierre Lunaire. In at least the Ravel and Schoenberg, the instrumentation is adjusted slightly movement to movement. What you should take away from this is that composers of the early 20th century were experimenting with different ensembles and sound combinations. This development continued throughout the 20th century, eventually leading to the invention of electroacoustic music in the mid-20th century. One last anecdote. When Mallarme's works became available for publishing rights, there was essentially a bidding war between Ravel and Debussy, an episode in which Ravel came out on top and which left Debussy more than slightly miffed. Before we go any further, let's take a look at the poem by Mallarme. This movement is entitled Soupir, which means sigh, as in to sigh. My soul rises towards your brow, O calm sister, where there lies dreaming, an autumn strewn with russet freckles, and towards the restless sky of your angelic eye, as in a melancholy garden. A white fountain faithfully sighs towards the azure, towards the compassionate azure of pale and pure October, which mirrors its infinite languor in the great pools, and on the stagnant water where the tawny agony of the leaves stir in the wind and digs a cold furrow, lets the yellow sun drag itself out in a long ray. So if you didn't catch all that, it's basically referred to as an expiring garden. This is where you get a lot of the imagery of autumn, the restless sky, the stagnant water and leaves stirring. We have a slightly melancholy work here. So let's see how Ravel approaches that from a compositional standpoint. Like I said, this series is essentially about understanding how my scores look at the end of the day, the kind of notes that I take that help me really get the most out of the piece. What are characteristics that interest me? What are some things that maybe I don't understand to the fullest and I want to go back and investigate to the fullest? Before we continue, we should first talk a little bit about the best way to understand or analyze Ravel, generally speaking. Ravel was a turn-of-the-century modernist slash impressionist from France. Contemporaries and the pre-impressionist ilk include Claude Debussy, Ernest Chanson, César Franck, and Gabriel Fauré. Like Debussy, Ravel thought primarily in terms of color, or tone color. This means he is more concerned with the color of a certain instrument or chord type rather than how this chord should be functioning according to traditional Western practices. What this means is that chord types, such as the dominant chord, a major chord with a minor seventh, traditionally functions as a five chord, which then resolves to the one chord. Ravel, however, just liked the sound of the dominant seven chord, not necessarily the function. Bear this in mind when you analyze Ravel. On the title page, you can see here Ravel dedicated each movement to a different composer, Stravinsky, Schmidt, and Satie, respectively. Here you can see my main takeaways from the entire piece. One, like Pierre Lunaire, the Schoenberg piece we spoke about earlier. Two, little to no melisma. Melisma means that there are many notes per syllable, opposed to pneumatic, which means one note per syllable. Plain chant and Renaissance music use a lot of melisma. Again, that's many notes per syllable. And three, interesting chamber ensembles. As we previously mentioned, this was not exactly standard chamber ensemble instrumentation for the time. Additionally, the instrumentation in the winds changes in the third movement to piccolo, flute, clarinet, and bass clarinet. Page one, you can see I've written in sigh to start the translation process. And I've written a little note in the left-hand corner, which states, an expiring garden, melancholy, October. These are the notes that I make to myself to, again, put this piece in context. What are we talking about? How is the music going to reflect the text? Secondly, again, you will notice my markings in blue for the chant stave, because that's the most important. I want my eye to follow that stave in between page breaks, page turns, or system breaks. Lastly, on this first page, you will start to see a general harmonic analysis. In this case, we have kind of a competing A minor, E minor tonalities kind of clashing right now. All right, let's just take a look at this first phrase here. You'll see I have written in the text, my soul rises towards your brow, O calm sister, where there lies dreaming. So Ravel is setting up this dreamy, somewhat languishing, wandering melody here. I should state that I do not speak French, nor do I speak German or Latin, but it is most of the time quite easy to find almost landmarks in the text where you can sync up certain words, fill out the rest of the phrase from there. And you can see that here where un autumn is obviously autumn. From there, I can backtrack and plug in certain words or phrases that I think are lining up correctly. Page 4, phrase 2. Here, I use the word russer to match up my translation with the word russet and angelique with the passage about angel eyes. Now, Ravel adds the piano with these little chordal clusters. Chordal means chords that are stacked in fourths. Then the flute enters, ascending for three measures, switching to harmonics on the high B, peaking on a high F sharp as the soprano sings the words white fountain, the soprano's highest note as well. This, to me, is an example of text painting, as I am imagining a flowing, silvery fountain, the high F-sharp in soprano signifying the height and subtle grandeur of a Greek fountain, though I'm sure one could interpret it differently. Page 6. Continued unsettlingly serene vocal line. A little more stability with a A minor chordal figure. Page 8. Even more stability, now with a low E chordal figure in the left hand of the piano. here is a good spot to point out what we talked about a little while ago about analyzing Ravel. I could drive myself crazy and try to overanalyze this section here, which looks like either maybe an A over F, maybe F augmented Mach 7, or I could accept that Ravel is merely creating a definite vibe portraying this expiring garden, and I don't have to make sense of every single note. Page 10. The descending chromatic figure continues in the strings. Looks to me like F minor over a G pedal tone. At rehearsal mark 4, here we have the same figure, at least rhythmically, in the piano that we saw in the strings. One could view this a few ways. One, that this is a vertical stacking of the octatonic scale. That is a scale comprised of whole step, half step. Or two, you can think of it as polytonality, where two chords slash keys are layered on top of each other. You can see I have penciled that in here. On page 11, Ravel is working in either A-sharp pentatonic or continuing to work with this idea of bitonal chords. At rehearsal mark 5, the strings enter again, this time con sordino, which means with a mute. As the text talks about the dragging rays of the sun, the piece begins to slowly unwind, beginning with this very, very colorful and unnerving slide from G down to F sharp. And gradually descending over the next 4 measures. Here I have highlighted the keynotes moving chromatically from F sharp down to E sharp down to E natural and finally down to D. In one after rehearsal mark 5, Ravel reinforces the entrance of the flute with a single note on the piano. This adds a sharper attack to the note. He does it again, doubling the soprano entrance. While the clarinets are playing sustained chords, illustrating the long rays of the sun. Page 14. The piece ends with a brief return to the initial statement. Back to the E minor chordal sonority. And now I will play the piece in its entirety. There we go. It is a pretty short piece. The combined three movements run about 12 minutes or so. I think it's a great piece, and I encourage you to take a deeper listen and check out the other two movements. I will put a link to my favorite recording in the description box. Feel free to like and subscribe, and I will see you on the next one.